need an immunity boosting foods to cure COVID. Why do you need coronavirus disease to prevent or to keep away the coronavirus? Why do you need immunity boosting foods? So I would like to ask all of you, or maybe all of you are mute, so you may not be able to answer, but you can chat and you can answer. So what food you must be taking during this? Are these topic worries? And our Prime Minister is so nice that, and Ayush, with the help of Ayush, he has already published some of our traditional medicines, or not medicines, maybe food that we have been taking, as you know, grandma's recipes. We have been eating garlic, of course, in India, as a many preparation, our none of the preparation goes without garlic or ginger. So it's the part of every preparation that we make, particularly in Indian context. So maybe if you see for the other countries, this garlic and ginger may not be a very regular use in their food preparations. But the big question you also must be facing, that what should I eat? What should I not to eat to avoid any disease or any viral infection? So not coronavirus, but any viral infection. Why? Because any viral infection will reduce your immunity, and then it will easily the coronavirus can attack. So better you keep away from any infection. So for any infection in general, you have been always recommended to go for fresh fruits and vegetables and avoid junk food. Am I right? So before I talk about the food that are very good for building or boosting immunity, I would say you first should understand what is immunity. So I may not go in much detail because it's a very, very technical topic, and I have been covering immunity and the foods and other things related to this. Around 30 lectures, I teach this to my master's, PhD and BTech students. So, but quickly, I would like you to go through all of these, like what is immunity? So immunity is nothing but the ability of an organism or a human to resist a particular infection, or any toxin by the action of specific antibodies or synthesized white blood cells. So I'm considering that you have a biology background or a little bit of microbiology background, so you understand how our human mechanism of digestion and how our body fights, what are the different cells that are present in our body. So basically, if you know, our body fights against the viruses, bacteria and many other diseases causing microorganisms. Otherwise, every now and then you would have you would have been sick, but that doesn't happen. Like you go to outside, in the environment, there are bacteria, on the surfaces, there is a dust, and everywhere there is, you know, viruses, bacteria. But then why don't you, why you are not sick every now and then? Because our body fights, it continuously fights. Why it fights? Because then there are cells in our body that helps us to fight against these viruses, bacteria, fungi. So in general, I will quickly give, this is also very, very detailed topic discussing on immune system. So basically there are two types, innate immunity, which is very non-specific immunity. And if you look at the innate immunity and or non-specific immunity, and there is a specific immunity. So quickly to give you an idea about innate immunity, which is, you know, basically a natural defense for you, of your body. For example, suppose you are walking, okay, without any shoes, and then immediately or suddenly a nail enters into your feet, okay? And then what happens? The blood comes out, and maybe on the nail surface there are lots of dust particle or some viruses or some of the bacteria. And the moment, and that's a, that, and our body cells identify that these are the foreign things, and then they start reacting. So what is the reaction? Immediately you will find an inflammation. Inflammation in the form, like your leg will be swollen next day. And this is because in our body there are cells which are fighting against, and inflammation is a body's reaction against the foreign particle. Okay, so I am not going to discuss in much detail the immunity, but you should understand what overall these cells are. So basically, primary goal is to prevent any foreign intruder in case it does enter the immune system. So what happens? These cells kills this foreign person. So you have basically physical barriers and chemical barriers. To give you an example, physical barriers means you have skin, like our body's skin. So if there are dust particles or chemicals or toxin, it has to pass through our skin, and which is very strong. Even if you have, you know, nails or viruses or bacteria or fungi, it will have to pass through skin. Very, very strong physical barrier. Then you have another physical barrier. The very good example is nose. So from the nose, if suppose there are some mosquitoes or insects or dust particles goes, so the first reaction, you say achoo. So achoo is nothing but your body's reaction. It's a reaction when you do not allow the body to go the foreign particle, and then, you know, the mucus comes from the nose, and that mucus, the sticky mucus, is nothing but a physical barrier. Then you have chemical barriers, like in the eyes you have lysozyme. So the water droplets in the form of lysozyme comes if something goes. So, you know, the water, a lot of the water comes from the eyes. Then in the stomach you have acid. So if you have sometimes, you know, many viruses, bacteria, if you are not a good immune person, what will happen? You know, suppose you eat pani puri, which is not good, and there are a lot of bacteria or viruses in it, then very next day or after 2 days you will have stomach ache or diarrhea or vomiting or some other symptoms. But if you are very, very good in the immunity, what will happen? Nothing will happen. It's because you have an acid, and the acid have a very, very high pH, and it will kill all the viruses, bacteria and microorganisms. So that is a chemical barrier that you have. So you will also think that, you know, the immunity varies from person to person, especially for Indians. You know, we are very, very immune tolerant because from childhood we have been, you know, coming in contact or coming in across with dust particle. Or for example, you know, I give a very good example. If sometimes you see a foreigner, the foreigner is visiting to your department, they always carry a water bottle. And they drink the water from the bottle. And if they drink the water from, you know, other places, they will fall sick. That means water has waterborne bacteria, E. coli, and then they cannot sustain those microorganisms and they fall sick. But particularly, sometimes I have seen people, particularly in our Dharavi, Mumbai area, or, you know, slum area, they even eat from the garbage. But still they don't fall sick. You must be wondering why. It's all because of the immunity. Since childhood, the person comes into contact with different types of viruses, bacteria, and that causes differences in each individual's immunity. Coming back to, you know, so if you, the foreigners, they are already living in a very clean area where the exposure to viruses, bacteria is very, very less. So in India also, we are very good at immunity. So basically, this is what I want to say about immunity. So inflammation done by mast cells. So then there is another type of innate immunity in which inflammation is done by the mast cells. These are the type of, you know, immunity cells. These cells constantly search for suspicious objects in our body, and they alert the blood, and then, you know, blood is rushed to the problem area, and this causes the inflammation, and then it brings the white blood cells. Those are called as a soldier. And I give you an example of dust and sneeze. Then there are another types, you know, under innate system, different types. You know, there are multiple number of cells are present in our body, which works different in different area and differently as a soldiers. So there are phagocytes, there are neutrophils, for example, pus cells, then macrophages. These macrophages engulf 100 pathogens, maybe at one time. If you have a very good immunity and number of cells, if they are more, the engulfing would be even more. Then there are natural killer cells, which will, you know, suppose there is a cancer cell present. So some of these cells might eat those cancer-affected cells. There are some of the cells which, you know, has capacity to identify the infection or the damage on the cells, which might be genetic or which might be due to free radicals. And so then they identify, and sometimes they completely kill them. So these are just, you know, different types of cells that are present and works as soldiers in our body. Then there is another type of immune system, which is called as an acquired or adaptive immune system. So basically, if you look at this immune system, this is more efficient, as it can differentiate between different types of pathogens. In the earlier immunity, the cells are not able to differentiate. So whatever they comes, you know, sometimes the good cells are also eaten, or good cells are also killed in the mechanism or in the fighting. So, but this adaptive or acquired immune system is very good, in which, you know, these system can identify whether it's a Salmonella typhi, or if it is a E. coli, or if it is a Clostridium, or it is a Lactobacillus, or things like that. So in this system, there are two main components, like you have L lymphocytes. Under these L lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, T cells comes into play when infection is occurred. It is called as a cell-mediated immune response. Then there are B lymphocytes, which fights with the pathogens that have entered or sometimes caused any infections. For example, it is called as a humoral immune response. Then sometimes you must have heard about antibodies, antigens, and you must have also heard about, you know, some of the diseases which are called as autoimmune disorder, in which the cells, you know, proliferate and they don't function properly. They do not signal properly. So these B cells produces chemicals called as antibodies. Those fits on the antigens, and then it's like a lock and key. And once these antibodies fits on the antigens of the pathogen, the killer cells, for example, can identify easily those cells with the marks on them. So the mark on the pathogen, the cells, some of the cells identify them, or for example, killer cells, and then they eat them, and that's how, you know, an infected cell is killed. So in conclusion, I would like to say that, you know, there are multiple number of very good animated videos about immune system, how it functions on YouTube. You can look at it and understand how it works. And so in conclusion, we have variety of immune cells that functions and that helps in body's immunity system. But you must be wondering that is this number increases or decreases? Yes, of course. The number of immunity cells increases, decreases due to chronic diseases or, you know, consumption of more antibacterial medicines, or stress in life, and many such things. So like this, it helps in body's immunity system. So how does food or nutrients helps in boosting immunity? So you must be aware about, please let me know if this becomes too much of technical. So basically, whatever food you eat, there are nutrients present in it. Why do we eat food? To get the energy or to survive, to walk. If you don't eat, what will happen? You will die probably. You will not immediately die. So for first week, you know, you won't be able to walk. You won't be able to perform a heavy functions, or you will just, then after 8 days, you will lie on the bed. You won't be able to even get out of the bed. So that's how, you know, the energy get lost, and then you need food. So food consists of nutrients. The nutrients are divided into macronutrients and micronutrients. So macronutrients are like, macro means big. You need it in a large quantity. So for example, carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, they are required in large quantity. Like carbohydrate, you should have more than, you know, 50% of your energy requirement should come from carbohydrate, and then proteins, and then lipid. Then you drink a lot of water. Then dietary fiber, it is recommended that you consume 25 gram of dietary fiber every day in your diet. Then there are very, very important nutrients called as a micronutrients. And so micronutrients are like vitamins, minerals, some of the essential oils or organic acids. So micro means they are required in a very small quantity, but they are not produced in our body. You must take them from outside, and their deficiency will make you sick. So it's very, very important. So just to give you a brush up about macronutrients, carbohydrate gives the energy to the body, and they come from chapati, grains like oats. You consume a lot of rice. So grain and grain products, you consume bread, toast, and all other products. Protein is basically to build your tissue structure. It is a part of organ tissues like muscles, your hair, your skin, nails, bones, ligaments, and all the blood plasma is made from protein. So protein comes from your legumes, lentils, peanuts, dairy like milk or paneer or cheese. Then you have soya beans, mung bean, and so forth, so on and so forth. Then lipids comes basically from oil that we consume, or we consume visible form of oil, like oil, you put it in everyday food for tadkas. And then you have butter, ghee, which you can consume directly, spreading it on the bread and things like that. Sometimes you have invisible fat in the form of nuts like almond, peanuts or walnuts and things like that. So micronutrients are very, very important one, and these are some of the list of the ingredient or constituent that you must include in your diet to have an increased immunity in your body. Now you will ask, suppose you eat today, tomorrow you will have a great immunity? I would say no. Immunity building is a very, very slow process. It is a long time job. One cannot build immunity in single day. So today you will say that, you know, madam has told me all these things and I'm going to eat all of these in one single day, and tomorrow I will have the greatest immunity fighting against all the viruses. No, students, this is not going to happen. This is a long process, but yes, the results are very, very good if you follow these things. So I'm going to talk about vitamins, then minerals, then some of the essential oils, spices, omega-3, omega-9 fatty acid, dietary fibers, probiotic, prebiotic, and overall advice on healthy diet and stress management. So now these, some of the words you might be feeling new to you, but too much technical. But nowadays, I think people or consumer are very much aware about all these terminologies. They are not no more jargons. Everybody, or particularly consumers, are more aware about all these nutrients, and we look at them before we buy any food item. So when you look at these beautiful pictures, what comes into your mind? Fruits and vegetables. It gives so much of happiness when you see fresh fruits, vegetables. It relieves your eyes. Am I right? So you can show me, or you can give me thumbs up, or you can in chat, you can say yes or no. So because, you know, it's like I cannot give only one way traffic. I want a two way traffic. So it energizes me. So you are my energy. You are my boosting catalyst. So when you see these fruits and vegetable, you feel so fresh. Imagine in this hot sun, or, you know, you consume everyday fresh fruits. You feel so fresh. Why? Because the nutrients that are abundant in these fruits and vegetables are nothing but, you know, fruits and vegetable has abundant of vitamins. So vitamins, since childhood, even my second standard daughter knows about vitamins. Even my nursery daughter knows about vitamins, because, you know, vitamins have been taught in the schools and children's, and even mothers, even if they are not scientists, people talk a lot about vitamins. They say, you know, this is a very good in rich in vitamins. But just to give you an overview, that vitamins are two types. One is water soluble and water insoluble, that is fat soluble. So there are total 13 vitamins, like four fat soluble, they are A, D, E, K, and then rest of them are nine water soluble, out of which eight are B vitamins. You say B is not one vitamin, it's a complex, or they are together. So they are B complex. Sometimes, doctor recommends you to take B complex and then vitamin C. So water soluble vitamins, and you see fruits, they have around more than 95% is water. All the vitamins are water soluble, but you have to also look for some fat soluble things or food items which will help you to get the fat soluble vitamin. So water soluble, no problem. Even if you consume in high quantity, because they are not readily stored in our body and through urine they are excreted. But fat soluble, yes, you have to be more watchful when you consume fat soluble, okay? Because they can accumulate and you can have hypervitaminosis. So vitamins basically are nothing but the metabolites are essential for a large number of physiological processes. And here there are multiple number of functions for vitamins, but I am going to especially speak on immune system. So I'm not just going to speak in the air that you eat vitamin A or D or C or E or B complex. I'm not just going to say that. For every statement, I'm a scientist. I'm going to give you an correct evidence. I'm not just saying that eat vitamin A and your immune system is going to be very good. So I'm going to give you scientific evidences. So the entire talk will be on evidences based, and I will try to be a little bit less technical so that you understand. So vitamin C and E members of the B complex can act in a relatively non-specific manner in the immune system. This is a very, very important statement, And then, so if you look at vitamin A and D, they can influence the immune response in a highly specific way. So I'm going to today not going to talk on all 14 or 13 vitamins, but very specific that will help in boosting your immunity. So overall, if you see, vitamin B12 helps in energy metabolism. You must have heard that, vitamin C is good for scurvy. Vitamin D is good for your bone, teeth, preventing osteoporosis. Vitamin E is good for your skin. You must have seen all the pharmaceutical or your anti-aging creams or many things that you see there. The advertisement, they say that rich in vitamin E to prevent aging and things like that. A good beautiful skin. Then vitamin D or vitamin K for good bone health. So these are the overall functions. So vitamin plays very important role in giving multiple functions. But today we will be very specific on mentioning the immunity because there is a not time also. Before going into and discussing about vitamin and the immunity and other ingredient and their immunity, I would like to talk on bioavailability of nutrients, not only vitamins, but overall nutrients. So now you will say, what is mean by bioavailability? You must have heard about this terminology. So bioavailability is nothing but it is the degree to which an ingested nutrient undergoes an absorption and then its metabolic function or utilization in the body. So you will be wondering why I'm talking to you this, because this is very important. Because sometimes you consume, but you don't know what is the wrong and why you are deficient in certain vitamins or certain minerals. For example, in India we have a very bad practice. Okay, what we do in the early morning, we take sometimes a cup of tea. Tea has a very, very high polyphenols or tannins. So, and then we add milk. So some of you will think that milk has a calcium. So I'm getting calcium in my body every day. I'm getting calcium, but here I would like to say that the calcium in the milk is zero bioavailable. Why? Because the tannins and polyphenols present in the tea binds with the calcium and they make it unavailable. So it's very, very important to understand the bioavailability. Suppose you every day drink milk, okay, it's plain milk. But sometimes it is not absorbed. Because for absorption of milk calcium, you need vitamin D. So there are multiple number of vitamins or minerals. For the absorption of one, you need the presence of another. For example, I would like to give another example. Now, sometimes, you know, particularly in India, we are more deficient in iron. So iron deficiency, why there is a more iron deficiency? Because for absorption of iron, you need to eat sour food or citric acid or ascorbic food. So in the acidic pH, the iron bioavailability is more. So presence of one is needed for absorption of other. Or for example, sometimes, you know, people are deficient, particularly in India, the fat soluble vitamins are deficient. Why? Because they will take vitamin supplements, okay, vitamin A tablets or D tablets or E tablets, but then still they see lots of problems like skin problem or deficiency of these vitamins problem. Why do you think still they see that? Because they avoid consumption of fat in the body. Consumption of fat in the body is very important, because for absorption of these fat soluble vitamin, if there is no fat, how it is going to digest? So each micronutrient, macronutrient is gone into the body. So this is, you know, the intestinal tract. Like it goes from mouth, it gets masticated, from the tract it goes to small intestine, then to the large intestine. It comes in contact with many enzymes. It is masticated, it is broken into smaller particles, for example, carbohydrate converted into glucose, proteins converted into amino acids, and vitamins are also converted into these smaller units, and these smaller units are then further absorbed in the body. So, for example, another example I would like to give you, like consuming synthetic vitamins over the natural. So the natural one are better absorbed than the synthetic one. So the bioavailability is very, very important. What type it is consumed, what form it is consumed. For example, consuming carrot in form of pieces and consuming carrot juice. So at a time, how many carrots one can eat? 4 carrots, 5 carrots. But in the juice, I can make a glass full of juice from 10 carrots or maybe half a kg of carrots, and I can drink. And it is easy for our body to absorb. So the time for mastication and digestion gets reduced. Of course, you need dietary fiber also, that I will discuss later. So for complete description of the nutritional adequacy of food, one must know that 3 factors, like the concentration of vitamin at the time of consumption, identity of various chemical species, like, you know, vitamin A is not only present in one form. There are 3 other forms of vitamin A. Vitamin B, there are many other forms. So which form? And each form chemically is so different that their bioavailability absorption is totally different. Like in vitamin D, you have vitamin D2, vitamin D3. In vitamin B6 itself, you have some other form. Vitamin A, there are other forms like alpha carotene, beta carotene, lycopene, cryptoxanthin. So these are all the different forms, you know. In vitamin E, you have retinoids and retinol, retinyl esters. Like these are the different forms of the vitamin. So which form you are consuming, whether it is in the active form, what is the concentration of vitamin? For example, the marketed juices which you get from the market, for example, orange juice or apple juice, you know. So you might think that you are getting very good concentration of vitamin C from the juice, but I would say no. Within 5 minutes or even less than or 1 minute of heating of the vitamin C rich source, whether it is apple or lemon, the 95% of the vitamin C activity is lost. Even sometimes it is greater. And do you know, vitamin juices are heated even at more than 100 degrees Celsius to get the preservation. It's always good to go for the fresh one. So bioavailability of these fresh forms are always better than the synthetic one. So the first immune booster I'm going to talk about, vitamin C. Vitamin C is also called as ascorbic acid, and it should be part of our daily diet. Why? Because it gives its role of immune boosting through antioxidants. So Rao, due to this pandemic, due to lockdown, you are not able to go out. There is a lot of stress, whether you are a student, whether you are so much under stress that whether your exam will take place, How will you appear for the exam? For the women in the house, they are facing the problem like how to bring the grocery, how to bring vegetable, if those vegetables I bring, whether they are safe for my children to give, whether they are free from viruses, and so many of other things. So that causes stress. So stress causes generation of free radicals. So if you have multiple number of free radicals, these free radicals, you know, kills the immune cells and your immunity goes down due to the stress. And these immunity, once it goes down, you fall sick. Your body becomes very prone for infection. So these vitamin C acts as a very good antioxidant. It's not only required for immune boosting, but it is also helpful in tissue regeneration. It helps in removing the chemical toxins because it is also called as a chelating agent. It binds with the chemicals, toxic compounds that are present. For example, you know, if you consume rotten peanuts, so there is an aflatoxin. So there is a toxin along with it. But you have a very good source of vitamin C in your diet. So what will happen? This vitamin C will bind with the toxin and you will no more have, you know, stomach ache, or you will not have food poisoning or foodborne diseases, and you will not fall sick. So that's a simple reason I'm giving. So it helps also in iron absorption. You will not feel anemic. It helps in also absorption of vitamin A, which is come in the form of carotenoid, which I will discuss later. And there are other vitamins which bioavailability and absorption is improved in presence of vitamin C. So, and the most important is it functions in the immune system. So you will say how much I should eat. And so basically, you can either take this through the food item, or you can go to the store and ask for, of course, the doctor's recommendation. But vitamin C, since it is water soluble, you can look for the tablets, or nowadays chewable and chocolate type tablets are also available. So, but recommendation of doctor, if you take, is good. So recommended daily allowances is 90 milligram per day for men, 75 milligram per day for women. So if you look for smokers and those who have more stress, the recommendation is increases, because you are then producing, you are giving lots of smoke inside. Smoke is nothing but chemicals and toxic chemicals, and then you need lots of vitamin C to bind with the free radicals that are generated. So this vitamin C is found in plenty of foods. You know, the best source, amla, which is very, very indigenous, the maximum and richest source, like almost more than 150 milligram in 100 gram of amla, you will get this vitamin C. Very, very high, rich source of vitamin C. So then citrus fruits like oranges are not always available, but then nowadays you have plenty of oranges in the form of Kino oranges or Nagpur oranges. They are rich in citrus, like vitamin C. Then guava, kiwi is also very good source of vitamin C. So for example, you know, here is a chart I have prepared for you. So this is the line, if you see, it's the recommended daily allowances and how much you meet. So for example, it is 75 milligram. So if you consume, look at this graph, suppose you consume guava, half cup of guava will result into more than 100% of recommended daily hour allowance meeting. Even kiwi is, because it's very sour, ascorbic acid, citric acid is very high. So you will immediately meet half cup of kiwi if you consume, like almost two kiwis or one kiwi, you will finish your recommended daily allowance. So it's that very simple. Even these other sources, you can look for like broccoli, or red peppers, like you have green Shimla mirch in India, and then red also capsicum. So these red capsicums are really, really very high, not only in vitamin C, but there are other nutrients also. They will build your immunity very nicely. Some of the dark green vegetables also has a slight less quantity of vitamin C. But point here is, easily lost in cooking. So do not do a very, very high cooking, for example, for vegetables, eat, but fruits you can wash and eat. Or juices also. So this is again the same pictorial thing. They are very, very high source in vitamin C, red and green peppers, strawberries. So sometimes you can choose, you know, seasonal fruits. Now you will see in the pandemic where we are going to get, but whatever you are, lemons are easily accessible, very cheap, easily available. Even during this pandemic, you will get lemon. So drink every day lemon juice or a glass of lemonade. You can prepare it freshly at home. Do not cut the lemon and keep it outside because vitamin C evaporation is at faster rate than grapefruit. And then in Indian context, you know, you must have seen this ambadi and ambarchuka. These are sour vegetable, very, very rich in vitamin C. People don't consume them. People don't eat them. Some people even don't know them. But in Maharashtra region, we found them, and in village places, these are very, very commonly consumed. So I would like to just say that, you know, amla is a very good source. Even mosambi, lime, lemon would be very good. Yellow peppers, red peppers are very good amongst the vegetable. Now here is the evidence I have found, and this is the research paper from a very good journal called Nutrients. It's a peer-reviewed journal in which vitamin C and infection have been evidenced. So this paper says that it is very important to maximize body's antioxidant capacity and natural immunity. I already explained how antioxidant capacity and immunity are interlinked, so that, you know, you can either prevent or minimize the symptoms when the virus attack in the human body. So there are not only this, you know, this is 2017 research paper, but the incidence of vitamin C as immune booster was recorded even before, like even 1940. The basis for using this is the paper from 1940, where the author have mentioned that using high dose of vitamin C to prevent and combat virus called illness may be traced back to vitamin C's early success against polio and first reported in 1940s. So many people are unaware, even surprised to learn this. And of course, you know, there are many incidences. I came across one research paper in which, you know, it is 2020 research paper in which they have said that this vitamin C protects against coronavirus. This is a very, very recent research paper, January 26, 2020. If you see, it is published in Orthomolecular Medicine News. So in this research paper, the author says that high dose of vitamin C enhances even cancer immunotherapy. And vitamin C protects against, straight away he says that, the coronavirus. Okay, so you can read this paper. I will post the link for you in the chat box. So basically, immune cells, the mechanism also explained in this paper, wherein so you must have heard, in cancer cells, the cancer cells, you know, infect the body, and then the cells proliferation occurs so fast a rate that, you know, all your cells gets infected. So if you have high dose of vitamin C, it will improve your, you know, cancer treatment. So the mechanism they have given is immune cell accumulate higher intracellular concentration of vitamin C, suggesting that this cofactor is crucial for the function of. So basically, the function of the immune cell is improved because of the vitamin C. And the next very good vitamin is vitamin A. Again, there are many, many incidences or evidences, scientific evidences, where vitamin A is considered as very good for building immunity. So this vitamin is very different from other vitamins, because vitamin C was water soluble, but this vitamin A is fat soluble, and it has different bioactive metabolites like retinoic acid, which has a hormone-like property. Then you have a retinol. Then it is synthesized from their vitamin precursor, like retinoids, retinol. These are the precursors, or these are the compounds that are present in the food items. Okay, carotenoid is a retinoid. So these carrot would have carotenoids, so beta carotene, alpha carotene, and things like that. Okay. So they exert their effects on target cells remotely by binding to nuclear hormone receptors. So these are present in three forms: retinol, retinal, and retinoic acid. So I have given here the link for one article in which they have clearly said and indicated that the immunomodulatory role of vitamin, like how vitamin A activates T and B cells. You must have heard how important the number of T and B cells activation. There are many people asking questions in chat, but I would rather give the answers for those questions. Please keep typing. I will answer it at the end. So let me finish my content first, okay? So I won't be able to answer the chat. So the immunomodulatory role of vitamin A has been very well explained in this paper. So vitamin effects on the immune system, especially they have spoken about vitamin A and D. And again, this is a paper which is very, very a good paper, that is Nature Review Immunology. Nature's paper are very good paper, and publishing with them is so difficult. So this paper is a peer-reviewed paper published in a very good journal. So they have explained the mechanism. And so vitamin A is a substance that make you ill if you don't eat. This is said by Albert Zenz in 1937. Which won the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine. So vitamin A deficiency is straight way associated with decreased resistance. I already gave you evidences. So what is it is involved in cell mediated, that is macrophag. I already given you the what is macrophag and antibody mediated responses. So it is directly involved in cell mediated macrophag and antibody mediated responses. So what are the different sources you must consume? So basically, suppose you eat carrots, okay, which is rich in vitamin A in the form of carotenoid. So you will say how much carrots I should eat. Suppose you eat, so there are units. So one retinol activity, that is a pure or original active form of vitamin A. So you need to consume double the amount of carrots. So 50% of RDA is made by eating 100% of the carrots. So half of the activity, like you will really need to eat more carrots to get the 50% of the retinol activity. So when you consume carrots in the form of beta carotene or lycopene or some other retinoids, so they go to the body and then they are converted into one form, that is retinol, with the help of many enzymes. It's a very, very detailed mechanism, which I'm not going to explain it right here. But the richest source of vitamin A, because through all the pathways, it goes and deposited in the liver. So if some of you are non-vegetarian, non-vegetarian, they eat livers of the animal. So it's a very rich in vitamin A, fish or fish oils and eggs. Especially, the yolk, the yellow portion of the egg is rich in this vitamin A, that is carotenoids. So these are carotenoids are found also for vegetarian sources. They are found in dark and green. And this is a picture. You should consume carrots. Papaya is so cheaply available in India. You have now the season for mangoes, apricots, tomato are also very good. But in India, we consume them in the form of cooked form. Or a puree form. So they are already cooked to get the high shelf life. Then you have pumpkin, spinach, sweet potato, but children particularly, adults, they don't like, college going children, they don't like vegetables and they don't like it and they go for a pizza, burger with lots of, junk food. But now after this, I am sure you will go for eating this. So if you look at the recommended daily allowances, if you look at the liver, it will easily meet your recommended daily allowances. Sweet potato is very good. It has a very good amount of vitamin like carotenoid. So it will meet almost 205% of your requirement. Carrots are good source. Broccolis are almost 150% daily requirement is needed and things like that. So you can refer these. Then the next very important vitamin is D. With the time constraint, I have to move fast. So some vitamin D is amongst the most important vitamin for immune function. So vitamin D is basically you get from food sources. and it is a fat soluble vitamin, and also there is an important source called as the sun. So sunlight converts cholesterol that is present under the skin, below the skin, and then it converts into vitamin. So there is another pathway which is a more detailed one which I will not explain. So then vitamin D then converted into active hormone in the liver and the kidney, and then so basically, you know, people will say that you know, I am going into the sun, so will I get the enough vitamin D? So there are lots of, you know, myths which needs to be, you know, clarified. Even anybody, if you go to the sun, you will not get vitamin D. White skin person, these are, you know, there are a lot of studies going on. If you are very fair skinned person, and if you even go for half an hour in under the sun, the vitamin D formation will be faster. The vitamin D formation in the dark skin people is very slow or sometimes no. So they are very, very deficient in vitamin D. So this is very, very important. And also the angle of sun, what is the time of exposure, and suppose you go in evening or 3 o'clock or 2 o'clock. So all these factors are very, very important when you consider the vitamin D. So intake is 5 milligram, or recommended daily allowances is around 5 microgram per day for people under 50, 10 microgram per day for 51 to 70, because then the bone starts degenerating, and therefore there is a more need of having vitamin D. And also, you know, the calcium absorption takes place only in presence of vitamin D. And then the requirement is even higher for 70 plus people. So this is just a screenshot I have taken. Vitamin D is present in cheese, in milk, in eggs or salmon, in yogurt. Vitamin D is present. So how much you should consume? So if you consume, you know, you get cod liver oil tablets in the market. If you get it through recommended doctors, they are very rich in vitamin D. And then, you know, some of the special fishes like tuna or salmon or herrings are very good source of vitamin D. So now the strong evidences. So evidences, this is the paper from Nutrition Journal, again a very peer-reviewed journal, is published in 2020, Nutrients, 2020, April 2nd. Very, very recent paper. So this paper says evidence that vitamin D supplementation could reduce risk of influenza, and straight away they say COVID-19 infections and death. So after listening to my talk, don't go straight away to the shop and buy lots of vitamin D and don't start consuming it straight away. Please take doctor's prescription, and if possible, don't go for tablets. Go for natural source, okay? But there are multiple number of resources or evidences, but I have chosen the most recent ones. So what this paper says, you know, so this author says that there are two proteins, like I will not go too much of, you know, in technical details, but this is very important and very, very interesting. So if you look, catelicidins and defensins are the two immune proteins which lower the viral replication rate. Okay, so these two proteins are very important in our body. So from where do they come? They come, or they are formed in presence of vitamin D. It's again a detailed metabolism which I will not discuss, but overall I will tell you that if you have enough vitamin D, you will have this presence of this enough immune protein. So these immune proteins, what do? They reduces the rate of multiplication of viral particles. That's what we want. We don't want the viral infection to, or viruses to multiply in our body. We want them to reduce the rate. So these immune proteins are important. So these immune protein also, they reduces the concentration of pro-inflammatory cytokinin. This is a too much of technical, but I will try to be more simplified. So what is this pro-inflammatory cytokinin? So these cytokinins are, these are the hormones, or in simple words, just they are the chemical cells that uses to communicate from one cells to another cells. Which cells? Like your immune cells. These cytokines are the hormones are useful or used by the cells to communicate. In immunity, the communication is very important. One cell communicate to another, and that is why the another cell is able to eat the infected cell. So communication is very important. So some cytokinin, there are some cytokinins which promotes the inflammation. Okay, they promote inflammation. And good levels of vitamin D reduces the concentration of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So to reduce the concentration of pro-inflammatory, reduce the inflammation. Don't get confused. So basically, in COVID-19, coming back to the direct point, what happens in the coronavirus affected person? There is acute respiratory distress. Like the person is not able to, breathe. Why the person is not able to breathe? I will explain this. I have drawn in the paint brush. So this is are you able to see my this is the bronchial tract with the alveoli. So basically what happens in the coronavirus affected person, the air comes from the bronchial tract and goes out. So in this process what happens, the oxygen is taken out, and from the blood carbon dioxide again oxygen is taken in and the carbon dioxide thrown out. So in the COVID affected person has acute respiratory distress. In
Dr.
which what Shalini, happens
sorry to interrupt you.
Near the bronchial tract, there is an inflammation. Because of the high inflammation, for example, if your foot has inflammation or there is, something happened. So there is a big inflammation in your
Dr.
foot.
Shalini, your marker is not visible.
There is a big infection. So because of this infection, there is a fluid comes out. And because of this fluid, the bronchial tract is
closed. I'm going to call her.
And this fluid closes the easy movement of oxygen or carbon dioxide. And due to what happened, the person is not able to take the oxygen. And when there is no oxygen, the person dies. So what happens? Avoid taking anti-inflammatory tablets. You will think that, I will take anti-inflammatory tablets or anti-inflammatory drugs. But vitamin D is much safer. So how vitamin D helps? Vitamin D produces these two important immune protein. And if you have two important immune protein, automatically you will have no infection. So even there are reports wherein this research paper says that the fatality rate of COVID-19 increases with the age, and you also know that those who have cardiovascular disease or those who have cancer or those who have immune suppressed people, the COVID positive test may come very easy because they have a less immunity. So why this is? Because this paper says that in these chronic disease conditions and also highly aged people, the vitamin D is also lower. So this research paper, I'm not recommending, this research group is recommending around 10,000 international units, like almost say 12.5 microgram of vitamin D for weeks. And then they are asking to reduce it 5,000 reduce that. So the next vitamin E is, I would like to ask Pawan how much time I have, minutes, if you can chat, I can.
Shalini, can you hear me?
I will show the sketch again. Okay, so I hope I have some. So the next very good boosting person is your vitamin E. So group of compounds which are called as the tocopherols, or they are alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Again, as I mentioned before, there are different forms, and so they have, all of them have vitamin E activity, and the most active form amongst all of these is alpha tocopherol. So again, what is the mechanism through which this work is vitamin E acts as an antioxidant, and again, point to be noted. This is a fat soluble vitamin, and the mechanism how it works through reacting with the free radicals, neutralizing them, and thus, you know, preventing the infection. So the recommended daily allowance for this vitamin is 15 milligram per day for men and women. And so this is again different sources. Like if you consume wheat germ oil in the market, there are tablets of wheat germ oil is available. Or if you have wheat, always consume the immature wheat. You know, those who have lived in the villages. The green wheat has a germ in them, or sometimes due to milling or polishing of the wheat, the germs have been removed because the germ has a lot of oil, and this oil causes rancidity and spoilage of atta. So therefore, they remove this wheat germ during milling and processing of the wheat. So it's always better to go for the whole wheat over the processed or refined wheat. Then peanuts, we are number one in peanut production. Peanuts are plenty and they are a very good functional food. They are rich in vitamin E. You can consume just like that, putting salt or roasting. And then you have sunflower seeds. Traditionally in village or here also, people have been eating sunflower seeds with miseli, or you know, just like that, roasting and making chutneys, red chutneys, powdered chutneys. Then almonds are also very good source of vitamin E, but they are very expensive. So maybe you can better go for peanut butter or sunflower seeds. So the recommended daily allowances, if you consume around sunflower oil, 1 tablespoon, your recommended daily allowances is around 40% is met. And the sunflower seeds is almost 40% or 50%. The next vitamin is also important, which is called as a B6 or pyridoxine vitamin, and it helps in building your immune function. It is present in non-vegetarian sources like meat, fish, poultry, and in a less quantity present in whole grains, breakfast cereals. Whole grain is very important because this vitamin is present in the bran layer. So, but if you are consuming polished or refined products like pizza, burger, bread, they are made from maida, which is refined, wherein the germ has been removed or bran has been removed. So you may not get this vitamin B6. Then amongst the category of vegetable, carrots, potatoes, spinach, have this B6 vitamin. So there is again another evidence published in some of the very good journal, like European Journal of Clinical Nutrition or Nutrient Journal. They have said that vitamin B6 supplementation increases immune response in critically ill patients. So if you consume, because you are in good health. So this is a Nature published article, and this is the link. So you can read this paper. And this paper says that a large dose of vitamin B6 supplementation, almost 50 or 100 milligram per day, could compensate for the lack of responsiveness of plasma PLP. So this was a very good study done on a very big number of patients, and wherein they have recorded this and recommended. Then zinc is a mineral which is very, very important to build your immune system. A very mild low level of deficiency in zinc can impair the immune function. You might not be knowing what is the use of zinc or why should I use, because we don't commonly talk about zinc, but it's very, very important. It has a multifunctional role. Many, many metabolic reactions are only taken place in presence of zinc. So the sources, I'm not going to explain it in detail because of the lack of time. So you have cashew nuts, if you consume oyster, or the best cheapest sources, we have plenty of chickpeas in India. So go for it and have a chickpea source. Then another, you know, technical term you must have heard about, omega-3 and omega-9 fatty acids. They are the essential fatty acids. They indirectly, not directly, they indirectly suppresses the inflammation. They keep the immune system in check. How? Again, it's a very detailed mechanism. I take around 10 lectures on teaching, you know, omega-3, 9 and 6, their sources. And many of my students have published very good research papers, especially using indigenous ingredient. How can you include, you know, omega-3 and omega-9 foods? We have developed lots of food. And the best source is, again, India is the largest producer of flax seeds. Chia seeds is a foreign, again, seed and very, very expensive, won't be affordable. But flax is a very, very good source of, in fact, largest source or maximum highest source of omega-3 fatty acids. So consume omega-3 fatty acids in the form of or through flaxseed, roast them, eat them, or make chutney, use them, put it in chapatis, put it in bread, make cookies out of it. For non-vegetarian people, there are some special type of fishes which are rich in omega-3. There are also tablets available through doctor's recommendation you can go for. Then one more, you know, probiotics, consumption of probiotic, prebiotic helps in improving immunity. So basically probiotics are nothing but the good bacteria. So traditionally we have been consuming curd, yogurt in our diet, daily diet to prevent, you know, sometimes your stomach is upset. You consume a bowl of curd. So curd is nothing but lactobacilli, which are the live good bacteria. So what do these bacteria do? So these bacteria helps in building immunity. So it's an indirect function. So basically, prebiotics are needed. So there are multiple functions of probiotic. So prebiotic is nothing but food for the probiotic. So these prebiotics, for example, dietary fiber is a good prebiotic. Onion has a lot of fructose oligosaccharide. So do you remember, like, in traditionally, we made salads or yogurt, koshimbir. In koshimbir, what you do, you take yogurt and put onions, tomatoes, coriander leaves and salt or black salt, and then you consume. So that is our traditional diet. But why? There is a scientific reason. Onion is a prebiotic, that is fructose oligosaccharide. And curd has a lactobacilli, that is a probiotic. So then when you consume probiotic, prebiotic together in the body, when this system, like this entire mixture goes together, the number of bacteria, good bacteria, will increase because they will get ready-made prebiotic food, and then they will produce short-chain fatty acid. These short-chain fatty acid has again multifunctional role. They build up the immunity. And then, you know, traditionally Ayush has explained the consumption of spices, curcumin, cumin seeds. We have been consuming these spices, you know, plenty in our daily diet. Coconut oil, clove oil, garlic, ginger. There are multiple evidences of, you know, antiviral, antibacterial, antifungal effect of curcumin and many other spices for cure and disease. So there are other things also which I'm not going to take in detail. So right now I would like to say in conclusion that prevention is always better than cure. Right now there is no medicine for COVID-19. That's what they say. Better we work on boosting our immunity, not eating tablets or synthetic chemicals, but through fresh natural fruits, vegetables, then also managing our stress through meditation, calming down, staying happily, staying positively, connecting with the positive people, and listening to such webinar talks will make you more positive and more knowledgeable. And thank you so much for listening to my talk. All of you, stay healthy, stay safe. Following these are just guidelines. You need doctor's prescriptions for all of the other things. But yes, natural food, you can straight away follow these guidelines. And I will be very happy now to take the questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Salini. You drafted your presentation so well and presented it in such a way that we were so happy to listen, and it was very, very useful. In fact, you know, it was so useful. In fact, now I will ask you, actually, when you saw the sketch,
yes, it was, I was
we were not able to see anything. If you can go back and sketch again, would be nice.
Speak
about that.
Yes, so this is the sketch. Okay. I wanted to share. Yes. This is drawn by me. For example, this is the bronchial tract, and these bunches like grapes are nothing but, you know, alveoli. So these alveoli, so this is the bronchial tract, from which respiratory tract, in which, you know, air goes in, goes out. Okay, so in which so from the blood carbon dioxide is taken and it is expelled out, and you have oxygen which is taken in. So in coronavirus disease, what exactly happens? These bronchial alveoli, they get inflated, so they get swollen, okay, due to viral infection. This is called as acute respiratory distress. So in this, due to this in inflation, because of the inflation, the fluid comes out, and because of this fluid, you know, the carbon dioxide or oxygen, they are not properly, you know, communicated or expelled out, and then therefore, you know, the person feels a lot of problem in breathing. So because oxygen, therefore no oxygen in the blood, and therefore they die. So if you take vitamin D, there will be immediate reduction according to the research paper that I justified. So this they have studied that this inflammation reduces immediately when you take, you know, large doses of vitamin D. So that was the
correct.
That was the thing.
Yeah. Thank you, Sarani, for nice presentation once again. So I will take question one by one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there are a lot of yes.
First question is once there was in a news that percent of vitamins and minerals are becoming less nowadays. Your comments.
Consumption of vitamin C is becoming lesser and lesser. What is the question?
No, question is the percentage of vitamins and minerals in any natural product. Let's say orange or apple.
These are all myths. Where they will go? See, the plants grow them. So of course their climate is changing, and that is the truth we have to accept. For example, you know, I stay in a metropolitan city like Mumbai, okay? And if I look the varieties of lemons or oranges that are actually in the village, I come from a village background. So if I go and taste the fruits in the village, they taste very different than the one grown on, you know, chemical fertilizers. So of course, you know, if you try to only have more quantity, but yes, so you will not get 100%, but at least you'll get 50%. So do not compromise and remove that myth, and do not, because of that, do not stop eating. So now it is the truth that I'm living in a metropolitan city. I cannot go to the village to eat only just fruits. So whatever is available, at least I will not meet 100% RDA, but I will meet 60%, 70%. So do not, you know, starve your body by deficiencing with the vitamins and thinking about, you know, the level is reduced.
Correct. Okay, so the next question is that which is better to consume, vitamins from natural products like apple, orange, etc., or from pills?
Of course, in my first slide I said that, you know, natural sources are always good. Our body is natural, and natural thing always get connected with natural things very easily. Okay, so there is a better absorption, and because the active form of the natural orange juice has vitamin C, and if you consume synthetic form or synthetic vitamin D2 or D3 and naturally from cholecalciferol, you are converting through the exposure of sunlight, so it is immediately, you know, absorbed. So but those who cannot go into the sun, or a very dark skinned person, even if you go for 2 hours in the sun, vitamin D is not going to get synthesized. So better that person take pills. For example, vitamin E source you are not going to get, because from where wheat germ oil you will find, or whole wheat atta from where you will get in this pandemic. So better go for tablets.
Yeah, so basically better go for natural products, but subject yes. to availability.
Yes.
Okay. Next question is that what would you suggest for a vitamin B12 deficient person to have in their diet?
I had a slide on vitamin B12, but it is not a very prominent vitamin. For the immunity, it is not like there are not much evidences. But yes, vitamin B6 is important. Vitamin B12 is also called as a folate. So fresh fruits, vegetables, and some of the non-vegetarian sources are rich source of vitamin B12. So you know, basically, I would recommend green and colored food. So your plate should be multicolored. So multicolored means orange, red, pink, purple. So that's it. And fresh, as much as avoiding synthetic food or preserved food, or you know, you get lots of preserved food. So you avoid that, have freshly cooked food and use as much as less cooking, because cooking destroys. B12 deficiency is maximum in India. Why? Because you know, without giving high tadka, we don't consume anything. In India, we want that tarr and that tadka. Without that, we know we don't feel like anything. Even you give, you know, you make dal. In that dal, you want tadka. And if you put tomatoes are rich in lycopene. But you cook them, you stir fry them at very high temperature. The temperature is even higher than, you know, 180, 200. What's going to remain? Can you imagine?
Correct.
Better to be avoiding high processing.
Perfect. Okay. So there is a question for a diabetic person.
Mm-hmm.
What to take? Fruit juice or fresh fruit? Yeah. As cut fruit.
Very good question. Diabetic is my area which is near to the heart, and I study the food for diabetic people. We develop and especially, you know, so fruits are rich in vitamins, but diabetic people cannot take fruits. For example, they are rich in fructose, which is a sugar. So immediately their blood sugar level will be high, so they cannot consume. But yes, there are certain fruits which they can straight away consume, which has sugar. For example, kiwi fruit, which is very rich in vitamin C, no sugar. They can take lemons, they can take grapefruit, very good. Immediately the glycemic index, or you know, the blood sugar level comes down. Now the next question is, like, they should consume juice or whole fruit. For diabetic people, I would always recommend them to go for whole fruit, because if you consume whole fruit, it has a lot of dietary fiber, and the dietary fiber again helps in, you know, increasing the area under the curve. That is, that sugar release will be, you know, delayed if you have more dietary fiber in. So juice is not recommended, but it is, again, you know, it depends, but always recommended to have whole fruit over juice.
Perfect. Okay, so there is a question from Soria Singh. Ma'am, why our body immune system does not attack those good bacteria in our gut? How these bacteria signal our body that they are our friend or not?
I didn't get this question.
The question is this, that our immune system, why does not attack the good bacteria present in our body?
Who said they attack? See, there are two systems. Like, it is a specific system, non-specific system. One system identify which pathogen, bad, good, or what. But the first system that I explained, they don't identify. While killing the bad cells, they kill the good cells also. Similar to like antibiotic. When you consume antibiotic, they will kill the bacteria as well as good bacteria also. So there is no right now mechanism. Of course, if your specific immune system, if it is very strong, maybe you have to build more immune system, and that is why you will not kill the good bacteria. And that is why we are here to discuss on immune boosting. So boost your immunity, and so that your body is able to identify whether this is good or bad.
Perfect. So there is a question that which asks that cooked amla, when you cook the amla, how much vitamin C remains in there?
Nothing. You know, I conduct practical experiments for my BTech students, where we take amla juice, whole amlas, we cook them immediately within first, and we study the kinetics, the degradation of vitamin C. Within few minutes, the vitamin, more than 90% vitamin C lost. Also the temperature, like at what temperature you cook. Suppose you cook at a lesser temperature, or you cook, there are many factors, like if you cook in open pan or under pressure cooker. So if you have pressure cooker, you at low temperature, the amla will be cooked faster. And if you have open cooking, the vitamin C is water soluble, it will get evaporated. So see, that is the reason you have to work out. But it is not. Vitamin C is the most light sensitive, heat sensitive, water soluble vitamins, and it will last within few minutes of cooking.
Perfect. Okay, so there is a question which says that can you suggest vegetarian stuff rich in vitamin B12? But I think you already answered.
Yes,
this.
I have told already. The spinach is very good source of vitamin right. B12, and I have already told.
What should be added in diet when a person is having calcium and vitamin C deficiency both?
If there is a calcium deficiency, you have to take vitamin D. Vitamin D is required for calcium absorption, and simultaneously you consume calcium sources. So what are the calcium sources? You drink plenty of milk so that you get calcium, because calcium is a mineral very, very critical. You know, it won't get absorbed if you have iron or if you have polyphenols. So suppose if you consume, you know, in the morning one cup of milk or one glass full of milk, and immediately after half an hour in breakfast you eat one apple, you will think that, oh, I got calcium, I ate such a good breakfast. But apple has polyphenol, and immediately after drinking milk, when the metabolism is not yet completed, you consume polyphenols, tannins, which is rich in apple, the calcium will be bind and it will be unavailable. So you have to be very, very careful when you choose your food. So you have to take vitamin D, either in the supplemental form or in the natural form. Take calcium in the form of milk or milk product, like you have paneer, you have cheese and many other, or tablets if you don't want to drink milk or things like that or product. And then for vitamin C, because calcium absorption is enhanced in presence of vitamin C, so eat sour things, you know, if you have lemon juice along with, you know, that is why paneer, you sprinkle lemon juice or paneer blocks, so it enhances the calcium absorption. So some modification we will have to do. And vitamin C is plentifully available, only you have to make sure that you consume them in the fresh form.
Perfect. So just for the information, what is the best time to go out in the sun for getting vitamin D? Although it's lockdown, so nobody can go out, but still when we go get chance.
Actually, there was one very good paper in Nature's article I was going through. So it's there are multiple factors, you know, they discuss. And then there's time of exposure, and the time of sunlight exposure is important. So earlier they said that the early morning sun is good because it's very light, and that is why you should go. And then, but then in that recent paper, last year it was published, and it highlighted that the India has the largest calcium and vitamin D deficiency in the whole world. It was Times Magazine they published, and they suggested that, you know, between 2 to 3 when the sunlight angle is 90, so that time if you go, your vitamin D synthesis will be good, and that too not for half an hour or 15 minutes. You have to literally sit for more than 1 hour, 2 hour or 3 hour. Also, third important factor, what type of skin you carry. If you are a fair skinned person, you will think that, oh my god, I will get tanned. But then, you know, the fair skin person can make vitamin D at a very faster rate. But even for 3 hour, a black skinned person will sit. No vitamin D. So people are researching, still they are digging out what is the mechanism, why, what could be the reason. But this is the advantage, I think, for a fair skinned people and dark skinned people. Otherwise, nothing.
Right. So, you know, this our Ayush Mantrala guideline, they suggest that take a milk mixed with the haldi.
Yes.
Golden milk, yeah. So your comment on that. And also there is a question, what is the best time to have milk, early morning or late in the night?
Yes, I wanted to include that, but I thought that somebody will ask question. So, you know, so milk is very good source of calcium. Then then turmeric, as I told, it is a very good antiviral, antibacterial, anti-infection, like it will prevent infection. So very good. one should take turmeric. So all over the world, turmeric is the boss now, you know, and it has already proven that it is the best. So, but turmeric has curcumin, which is responsible for all these property. But this curcumin is fat soluble. If your milk has no fat or it is a skimmed milk, the absorption of curcumin will be very poor. Otherwise, you know, you would have taken a spoonful of turmeric and eaten just like that. But bioavailability is zero. You know, there are multiple research paper I was referring very recently. So in the people have studied in the stool, the entire turmeric as it is was found. Okay, yellow. So the curcumin was zero absorbed. So the moment you have fat, and that is why in traditionally in India, when you are putting tadka using oil, we put turmeric. So don't put turmeric in the vegetable or legumes or lentils directly. I say, what you do, take oil when you are putting tadka, put turmeric so that the curcumin is extracted because it is a fat soluble in the oil, and then only in presence of fat or oil, it is absorbed. Coming back to milk. So if you have a whole milk, which has around 3 to 4% of fat, the curcumin absorption will be better. So now Ayush recommended, Ayush when recommended or during tradition, there was no skim milk or double toned milk or triple toned milk or zero fat milk that time. So they considered that whole milk along with curcumin works best, and it works best because curcumin gets absorbed and it gives antibiotic. But nowadays we have 4 different types of milk. So you make sure that you drink whole milk, and drinking it at any time is always good. In the night, I have read some paper. It soothes your body. It calms down, and then you get a very good sleep. Curcumin has that property of, you know, even calcium in the milk. Actually, milk has some bioactive peptides which enhances the sleep. So if you drink milk, you'll get the sleep.
Correct.
Due to those
basically, if you are using double toned or skimmed milk, just add half a spoon of ghee in that, and then
yes. Right. Or better, you know, why you are making life complicated? Like, you know, with the technologies, I always say we make our life more complicated. What we do, we remove the fat, and then now we realize, oh, fat is needed. Ghee is rich in vitamin A, carotenoids. Let's put back. So when it is in natural form, it has more active ingredients. So again, yeah. So better go for the whole milk than, you know, removing, putting back. So I would recommend taking whole milk. And
so there was a mention that tomato, you fry them, so it's not good, right? The carotenoids are
lycopene or the carotenoids. They are fat soluble. But also they are heat sensitive, and they are light sensitive. So if you fry them, it is called as a auto-oxidation, or it is called as a degradation. So immediately the lycopene form, it changed. Its chemical structure, it changed, and it is no more available in its natural form, or it is in bioavailable form. So it's always better to eat cut tomatoes, and for better absorption, you can have, you know, olive oil sprinkled on it in the form of salad dressing, so that, you know, you have omega-3 as well as better absorption of these lycopenes.
Good. So there are a lot of words for praising you. But last question is that by Hridaya Chauhan. She is asking, if a person is already suffering from breathing problem, how to deal in this COVID time?
Oh, it's a very challenging question. I'm not expert about that, Hridaya. I am sorry. Maybe you only with my own experience, because I also follow lots of meditation techniques. So for breathing, those who have a problem of breathing, go for yoga, pranayam, and just some breathing exercises. And best is do if possible 15 minutes of meditation, which will definitely help you to recover. As such, for breathing problem, it's a very complicated topic, and I'm not expert in that.
Nicely answered. Meditation is always good, even
yes.
if you have this problem or not. But if you have this problem, of course, they will help you. Sonia Chaudhary is asking whether is it good to have a powdered nor soup.
Oh, very good questions. Very good. See, I said, and I again repeat, you know, we are the food technologies makes our life, you know, complicated. Like, you know, so powdered nor soup, what is it made from? Spinach. So the dehydration of the spinach is done. Tomato is dehydrated. So why it is done? Because, you know, to give more shelf life to spinach, tomato, and people are becoming so lazy. Don't have time. The lifestyles have changed. So they are in hurry. So they want instant soup. And that is why. And it doesn't have anything. No vitamin, nothing, until they say that fortified synthetic powder has been added. But I don't think in the Nor soup they have added anything as such. You have to see it on the label. But they have more starch, like carbohydrate. So it will give you energy, but not any kind of vitamin. But if you prepare a freshly cooked spinach, if you extract the spinach, you will get all sort of vitamins. If you extract the tomato extract, you will get all sort of, you know, vitamins into it. So freshly prepared soup is always better. But nowadays we don't have time, so we straight away go for the Nor soup.
Yeah, but during Corona times, everybody should, at least in this time, everybody should take not this powdered one, but the
but
prepare
yes.
them.
Because we have time, we have plenty of time. So I think we should take care of our body by nourishing it. And body is our temple, and it is our responsibility. It is our duty to take care of it by nourishing it with the good food. How can you expect that your body should perform excellently? Do you know people dream like they want to look beautiful, like this actress, that actress. But how much care they take on their food items, you know. They eat plenty of fruits, vegetables, but how much care we do? Do we exercise daily? Do we meditate a lot? Do we eat fresh fruits and vegetables as per the recommendation? I think we just have plenty of excuses.
Right. So Neha is asking again, is it good to have sea cod pills?
Yes, it is good to have sea cod pills, because many times, you know, getting these E, vitamin E or A source is not possible sometimes due to, you know, a very fast life. So yes, if you feel that, you know, you are not able to meet it through the diet, go for the tablets, of course with the doctor's recommendation. But I would always recommend to go for having fresh fruits, vegetables, and vitamin A and E is available in almonds. So, you know, have almonds as a snacks, or if you think that almond is not affordable, go with peanuts, go for sunflower seeds, go for flax seeds. They're very, very cheaply available. Just you need to roast them, put some salt, and keep it accessible places, and keep eating. Sesame seeds, again, very good source of omega-3. See, cod liver oil is omega-3. So, but those who are non-vegetarian sources and they cannot eat sesame seeds or sunflower seeds or flax seeds, they can go for cod liver. When you feel okay. that you are not able to meet the requirement of your vitamin through, but then make sure that these are the fat soluble vitamins, and you may face hypervitaminosis. Remember my first slide, because if you consume it in a large quantity, it will affect you badly. But through natural food, if you consume, the chances of hypervitaminosis is always less.
Yeah, so we are running really very much out of time, but once again, this last question, that many papers suggest that vitamin K should also be taken along with vitamin C and calcium.
It is vitamin D, Dr. Pankaj.
Vitamin D, yeah.
Vitamin
D and calcium, yeah.
Yes, I already suggested the girl who asked question of milk and vitamin C. So vitamin C helps in better absorption of calcium. Calcium absorption, vitamin D is needed. So all these three together gives, you know, very good symbiotic effect. So yes, you are right. Vitamin C is very, very important. And that is why the first vitamin that I discussed was vitamin C. Very essential and most ignored one. You know, ghar ki murki dal barabar. We have plenty of it, but we do not, you know, take it so seriously. It's very easy to take vitamin C source easily. Instead of, you know, just plain water, squeeze one lemon, drink it. Your vitamin C requirement will be fulfilled. Easy, perfect. Very easy.
Perfect. So now there are comments. Ansu says that, thank you, ma'am, for fantastic lecture. And then Rakhi Nagar says, thank you very much, ma'am, for answering my question. And Hirdaya Chauhan says, thank you very much. Very good lecture. And then Nishad, this is Nishad, our Nishad, I think. Very useful lecture delivered with your usual enthusiasm, Salini. Joined a little late, so missed the earlier part, but the answering of the question was very, very good and great. Regard Nishad.
Yes, Pankaj. Shalini,
you're there.
Hi, Nishad. I'm so happy to see you again.
Shalini, it was very, very informative. In fact, I was just asking my kids also to listen to the question answers part. Because, you know, you were insisting on eating this whole fruits and not the juices and all that, which they typically want.
Yeah.
So we have recorded. Thanks for a wonderful, useful lecture. Yeah.
Great.
Thank
excellent.
You so much,
so,
for listening.
Yeah, so whatever I missed, I will listen to you
again.
Great, man.
So we have recorded this and then we'll put on INIA's YouTube channel very soon.
Excellent.
There are many other comments by many people. All are thanking you, Salini. So
I should thank Pankaj and the entire department and the organizer, and the big thank you for active participant, for listening me, for asking questions, and it's wonderful. You know, I am just energized after this talk. You know, it's very beautiful.
You are always energized, actually. whenever we listen to you, Salini, we get energized from you.
You all are my catalyst, you know. Now I feel so good, you know. These days, due to coronavirus and this pandemic, you know, I'm really, you know, lots of negative thoughts here and there. But immediately, the moment I see these so many positive vibrations I'm getting, I'm overwhelmed with the joy, you know. I can get and I can feel those positive vibrations into me. So I don't know whether you people believe in that, but I believe. Connecting with the positive people, I'm now fully recharged and I can live for next lockdown also. I can survive with this.
Shalini now.
Okay. Great. So moving on, Ansu says, thank you, ma'am, for fantastic lecture. Swati says, nutrients for ears too. You see? Then Swati again says that you have got such a beautiful voice, ma'am.
Aww.
And then there is one user which says that very informative, awesome. Thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you so much, Pankaj, and your entire team. It's a great job. Congratulations to the entire team for organizing. And big thank you to all of you for giving me an opportunity to present whatever knowledge based on my teaching and my research I had. I could present that. That's it.
It was very lovely to listen to you, Salini. And I now hand over to IHE team, Dr. Aarti Kumari.
Thank you so much, Dr. Salini. It was a wonderful lecture. And I'm sure all the audience, they are benefited with it. And they will follow that eating good, eating healthy is very much required for every person to combat with any kind of diseases they have.
Thank you so much, Dr. Aarti.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you once again. And before switching this meeting off, I would like to ask all the audience to make their video on and my IHE team to make their video on so that we can have a screenshot.
One photo.
Together.
Yes, one photo, one selfie.
Now you all can make your video on.
Yes, you can all come life.
Yeah, but because of mobile, I think I'm not
Yeah,
able
people are
to
not
speak
able
with
to.
Chalini. Yeah,
Tehri, are you
I would
there?
have loved to take a picture with Chalini, but
Tehri?
yeah, Aarti, I'm there, but I think some problem with the network. I you know, video is not coming.
Sonia ma'am, are you there? I can't see you.
Pankaj, I hope you can hear
me. I'm using mobile phone actually.
Oh, Ashima ma'am, Mithika ma'am.
Here goes my selfie. I already taken my selfie.
Dr. Shalini, it was very nice, very informative lecture. We learned many things I can't explain.
Oh, thank you so much. These are all there. These are already the research papers. I just did compiled it, and then I teach food chemistry, like chemistry of nutrients. I teach human nutrition. So all these content was based on my own teaching experiences and research that I do. And basically we work on traditional foods. And then, you know, in India, basically there are many poor people. If you go to doctor, they will recommend so expensive tablets, which are nothing but extract of tomato, extract of spinach, extract of this. Better you eat a bunch of spinach, is just for 3 rupees, such a big spinach we will get. But you know, poor people don't understand. And these big companies also, I'm sorry if there is some pharmaceutical background person, they are making so much of money, but they are doing nothing great. They are just taking food. And nowadays, you know, eating tablets or medicine will go. People will always prefer food, natural medicine over the synthetic one, because this is going to come. So better we make ourselves, you know, aware about the food which are good.
Can you tell us how can we take these flax seeds or sunflower seeds? Can we mix this in wheat flour?
Actually, mixing it with the wheat flour and keeping it will cause rancidity, or your flour, you cannot keep it for long. Because the moment you grind it or you put it in the wheat flour as such, because you know, they are rich in omega-3 and omega-9. And omega-3 and omega-9 are PUFAs, like polyunsaturated fatty acid. They are unsaturated chains. So immediately the moment they come into contact with oxygen or air or light, the oxidation starts, and then you know, they get rancid, and then you will get a very off taste. And then their activity also gets reduced. So it's always better to have them in the whole form. So don't grind the flax seeds. Consume whole flax seeds. Consume whole sunflower seeds. So how you can consume? You have muesli or you have oats. So you can sprinkle these sunflower seeds on the oats or along with the fruit, you know, cut the fruit, make a salad, sprinkle flax seeds or sprinkle spun. So consume as a whole. Or you can, you know, just roast them, salt them, and consume it whenever you are walking in the home. Like how we consume after eating food, we consume sauf. So sauf ke saath aap dher sara flax seed ya you put those sunflower seeds and keep eating. So your omega-3 need will also be fulfilled.
Thank you so much.
Don't heat it. Don't grind it at a very, very high temperature, and put it in the whole wheat flour is not a good idea.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Dr. Sunita Agrawal, you have to unmute
Yes, okay, thank you, Pankaj. If you permit, and if there are no more questions, I would like to then leave. Am I allowed to leave?
Dr. Shalini?
Yes.
Because you are working on diabetes, like I have some queries regarding diabetes. Can I mail to you those questions if you have no problem?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
Like you are working with the diabetes, basically. So if you have, I have any queries, can I email you?
Yeah, sure. You can email me. You can take my number from Pankaj. You can WhatsApp me. I'll be very, very happy to assist you or help you or advise you based on whatever research.
Thank you so much, everyone. And before switching off this meeting, I would like to tell you that tomorrow we'll have Dr. Mudrika Khandelwal from IIT Hyderabad, and she will be speaking on women in science in Indian perspective. And in the evening, we'll have Dr. Ragini Garg from Shivnadar University, and she will be speaking on CRISPR-Cas. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Sarani.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you all.